Now we're going to touch very briefly on one of the most important topics in linear algebra. It's called the singular value decomposition, or SVD. Unfortunately, this is an advanced topic that goes beyond a typical introductory linear algebra course. So what we're going to do is to relate this important operation to the low-rank approximation with which we started this week. And we will mention the fact that it allows you to determine the best rank k approximation to a matrix. We started the week with a matrix B that was the matrix of the pixel values in a picture. But if you are given an arbitrary matrix in M by N, let's call it B, then it's always the case that you can write this as the product of a matrix U, a matrix sigma, and a matrix V transposed, where both U and V have orthonormal columns. R here is the rank of the matrix. Recall that that's the number of linearly independent columns of B in this particular case. Sigma is a square matrix with entries sigma 0 through sigma r minus 1 on the diagonal, all of which are positive, and they are ordered from largest to smallest. These are known as the singular values. Okay, now what is it that we can do with a singular value decomposition? Well, let's home in on this a little bit more. Here, we view our matrix U as the columns that constitute U. Remember, those are orthonormal because U transpose U is the identity. And V also has orthonormal columns. And then here we see that sigma is this diagonal matrix, positive entries from largest to smallest along its diagonal. In week 4 or 5, we learned that if you multiply a matrix partitioned by columns times a diagonal matrix, then all you had to do was scale the individual columns. In other words, this right here is the matrix sigma 0 u 0 for the first column, sigma 1 u 1 for the second column, and so forth all the way up to r minus 1. This matrix right here is just the matrix v 0 transpose, v 1 transpose, through VR minus 1 transpose. And then in week 5, you learned how to do partitioned matrix-matrix multiplication, and you saw that the result of multiplying this together is just this times that plus this times that, and so forth. And that gives you this expression right here. Now, what is this? This is a scalar sigma 0 times a column vector times a row vector, plus scalar sigma 1 times a column vector times a row vector, and so forth. Now notice that each of these is a matrix of rank 1. So this is really a sequence of R rank 1 matrices added together. Now, the real power of the singular value decomposition is exposed when you think of the columns of U and V and the singular values as partitioned into a set of k singular values corresponding to k columns here, and then the rest of them. These values are in order, so these are smaller than those. And it turns out that if instead of using those values, you simply set these to 0, then you end up with 0 blocks here. And lo and behold, if you multiply this together, all you get is this times that, which if you multiply it out, is this, except with all of these rank 1 updates taken away. And notice that what you're left with here is a matrix that turns out to have rank k. And this turns out to be the best rank k approximation to the matrix B with which you started. So here we have the rank k approximation to B, so this should be an approximate sign. If we go back to the picture with which we started the week, that was our matrix B, then we can either approximate that by doing this business of picking a couple of columns in the picture and then projecting each of the other columns onto the space spanned by the columns that were picked. And we can pick k columns, in this case k equals 1, or we can use k of these terms from the singular value decomposition. And on the right, I'm going to plot what happens if we use the singular value decomposition for our approximation. And on the left, I'm going to use what we did earlier this week. And you can already see that with k equals 1, the picture on the right looks much more like the building that we want to end up with than the picture on the left. However, by the time we're looking at k equals 2, you can argue that the picture on the right is slightly nicer than the picture on the left, but it's actually not that noticeable. If we go to k equals 10, the picture on the right is slightly sharper, but you have to have a pretty good eye. And maybe in this video it doesn't even show up. By the time you get to 25, again, it might be slightly sharper, but maybe not. And finally, with 50. Now here, when you get to k equals 50, you might be able to see that the trees here have a lot more definition than the trees on the left. The fact, though, is that this picture has so much repetition in it that if you just take equally spaced columns, you actually do okay. So we have a notebook for you with which you can try different pictures to see whether the singular value decomposition does significantly better than the rather crude way with which we started the week. Hopefully you'll get something out of that notebook. You can also use the singular value decomposition to solve the linear least squares problem. What do we have there? Well, let's say that we have a matrix A and we know it's a singular value decomposition. And let's assume that A has rank n. Now what that really means is that V is an n by n matrix. It's a square matrix that has orthonormal columns. And remember that that means that V, V transpose is the identity and V transpose is the inverse of V. What if we want to solve AX equals B? Well, start with X. We know that we can multiply B by the pseudo-inverse of A. And then we can take the singular value decomposition and plug it in everywhere where an A appears in this formula right here. Now notice here we're transposing, and notice when you transpose, you write the matrices in opposite order and you transpose each of them. So you get this for that and this for that. Then you recognize that this is just the identity. So you get here. Now, we need to invert this. Inverting the product of a bunch of matrices means writing them in the opposite order and inverting each of them. So you get this. But then you remember that V transpose is the inverse of V. So this is inverting V twice, so you get V back. And this here is just V transpose, or you can leave it as V inverse and multiply it times V and get the identity. Either way works. When you do that, you get this. But now you have the sigma, the diagonal matrix, inverted times itself. That's the identity as well. And you get this right here. So if you have the singular value decomposition, then you can use this formula to solve the linear least squares problem. The singular value decomposition is a very important topic, and unfortunately it's beyond the scope of this course. In the enrichment section of this week, I will have some pointers to some notes that allow you to learn a little bit more.